to come and try to get me. I'm taking everything with me.
Different church, welcome. If you're new here, if you've never been here before, man, thank you. Thank you for being part. My name's Tyler. I am the pastor here. And real quick, I just want to say thank you to everybody that serves in person, everybody that edits, everybody that does worship, everything. I just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. We're in a series called Sprung, okay? We've talked through being single. We've talked on dating. Now we get to the end of it where we talk about marriage. And we've had people, hear me, we've had people almost like reach out and say like, hey, you know, I'm married. I didn't really need the talk on being single. Or I'm dating. Marriage isn't really a thing. Can I tell you something about the word, about the Bible? The Bible does two things. It inspires you or informs you. Sometimes when we read the Bible, we'll read it and it'll just be downloading. It inspires you, it challenges you, it moves you. We love those things. We love to read about that stuff. But then there are sometimes you'll read something and you don't think it's super relevant or it doesn't affect you. And you're like, I'll skip over this. No. It's meant to inform you because somebody else isn't reading that passage and they may need it. So the Bible does two things. It inspires or it informs, but we can't pick and choose and skip through the Bible, skip through passages just because we don't like it or it's not relevant to us. We're reading it because somebody else won't read it. And God is using us in our study, in our devotion time to reach people. Not just, the Bible's not just for me, it's for them too, but they may not read it. So when I skip over passages, I'm almost hindering what God wants to do in someone else's life because I don't want to read it. Two things. And so whenever we talk on singleness and you're not single, maybe you need to take notes because you know someone that's single. Maybe you're dating, you don't want to get married. Everyone knows somebody that's married. Everybody knows somebody. Maybe it's not just for you, but it's for you to take and deliver to somebody else. And so we're talking on marriage. And if you're single and you're like, oh, I'll click off. No, don't. Because you know someone that's married that may be struggling. You know someone that's hurting that's married, and this could be your way. I don't want to preach to them. You preach to them. This is your opportunity. Take the passage, take the word, take a quote, whatever, that might encourage somebody. It doesn't have to be me. It can be you. And that's what I love about the word. That's what I love about what the Bible says. So we're talking about marriage, right? Everybody has this idea of what they want marriage to be like, right? Like, I can't wait to have the horse and carriage pull up. I love watching dating shows, The Bachelor, right? Everything's about finding the perfect person. And that's cool, but we also have to figure out what marriage isn't. Like for me, hear me. You don't get married because you're lonely. You don't get married because you're insecure. You don't get married because you're broke. You get married because you find somebody that has the same calling as you and you're ready to chase after it with somebody. That's why you get married, not because you want somebody to watch Netflix with you. You can find anyone. You get married because you have found somebody that's ready to take your calling serious and they're ready for you to take their calling serious. That's why you get married. Two people chasing after the same calling is much more effective than one person. But we can't just get married because it's something fun to do. No, marriage is something you become. It's something you become. And we get it so twisted. We think, oh, I want the cutest wedding hashtag. Oh, if I can just have, I wish, honestly though, can I talk to you real quick? I wish I'd have a wedding hashtag. It wasn't popular when I got married, and so I don't even know what ours would be. Now that I'm thinking, I don't even know what my hashtag would be. I'm gonna figure it out and come back and tell you. But we get married for all the wrong reasons. Everyone's doing it. Well, marriage isn't for everybody, is it? Is it? And so we have to run to the Bible, run to what God says marriage is, and go, okay, I think I'm called to get married, or I'm married right, hear me, I'm married right now and it's not working out. So if you have a Bible, you turn to Ecclesiastes 4. I love Ecclesiastes. Love it. Ecclesiastes is kind of like a book where, you ever seen those things where like the celebrity will like tell all of their like dirty secrets after they're famous and they're about to pass away or something? Ecclesiastes is kind of like Solomon, right? Solomon was like the most rich, powerful, wise man, one of the most famous people on the planet, and he wrote this book kind of telling everything, kind of tell all, right? Solomon tell all. And so we get to Ecclesiastes 4 verse 9. Look at what he says. Two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other can reach out. Hey, look, already two times it's already said one word. Let's read it, run it back. Verse 9. Two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other can help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. Likewise, two people lying close together can keep each other warm, but how can one be warm alone? A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. At the very beginning, what was the word that was said multiple times? Help! Help! Two people can help each other in a marriage. You help. What did God say about Eve? What did he say about Eve? We said it in another passage. I am making Adam a what? Helper. Like somebody to help me. Not to have sex with me. Not to help my income go like double or whatever. Not to help me watch Netflix. No, to help the calling God's put on his life. Isn't it crazy how our success is attached to somebody else? Like my success, if I get into a marriage, hear me, if I'm in a marriage, my success is contingent, not on my works, our works. I've allowed them to come in. So I've got to ask myself as a husband, you've got to ask yourself if you're married or want to be married. Look, do I help? Do I help? Do I help my wife be everything God's created her to be? Do you help your husband be everything God's created him to be? Do you? And if you're dating and you want to get married, when was the last time you even talked about, hear me, when was the last time you even talked about callings? When was the last time you even talked about what God put in your heart? Because if you haven't even talked about that, you're done. You're done. You're doing something that you haven't even talked about the Spirit. You haven't even talked about the deep things that God wants to do. So at the very beginning, look, two people are better off than one. Why? For they can help each other. If you're wanting to get married, you are not looking for someone to have sex with. You are not looking for somebody to watch Netflix with. You are not looking for somebody that's going to help you make more money. You are looking for someone that's going to help you do everything God's created you to do. But if you're dating and you haven't even started talking about dreams, passions, and callings, if the person you're dating has never asked you what God's called you to, you need to leave. They're not in it for the spiritual. They're in it for the physical. Listen, I don't need you to marry my body. I need you to marry my soul. I need you to marry the thing that God put inside of me. And that's what he's saying. Your success is contingent on somebody else. And if I want to succeed, if you want to succeed, if you want your marriage to succeed, it has to be in the eternal. It has to be in the kingdom of, it has to be. It just has to be. But we get married for every other reason. It's cute, it's popular right now. We get married for everything else. But this says right here, verse 9, two people, your marriage is better. Hey, if you have somebody with you, it's better, for they can help each other succeed.
What's up, everybody? My name is Darius. Welcome to the Different Church YouTube campus. Couple things I need you to do before we jump into today's message. Subscribe and hit the notification button so you can stay up to date with all the sermons that we have coming up. A few more things. If you're on social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Different Church Nashville, hit that follow button, hit that add friend button. Follow us, stay up to date with everything that we got going on. Also, if you are a Different Church member and you call this great church home, hit that generosity tab if you feel so led to give to our church, to give to the vision, to give to what we have going on, and to give to what God put on our hearts for this city of Nashville. And last thing, wherever you're watching from, hope God speaks to you in a mighty way. Here we go.
In verse 10, it says, if one person falls, the other can reach out, here's that word again, and help. But someone who falls alone is what? In real trouble. Falling isn't the trouble. Falling alone is the trouble. And this is for married people, hear me. The longer you're married, the more numb you are to your spouse falling. Because I've been married for almost 10 years. I've seen my wife fall all the time. She's seen me fall all the time. We get numb to it. Oh, you're struggling? Just like last month, just like the month before that, just like the month before that. No. I am here to help her when she's in trouble. And if you do not have a significant other that helps you when you've fallen, that helps you when you hurt, if you are not a spouse that helps when they get hurt, it's okay, let's get better today. Right? Like, it's not like there's this condemnation or you're the worst human being that's ever existed. There's none of that. But today, let's get better. Today, I'm gonna help my wife up. And you know what else I've seen? And this is just for married people. Remember, I've been married for like 10 years. Sometimes you enjoy watching your spouse fall, don't you? I mean, I've been roommates for 10 years. I kind of like when she messes up. No, my marriage is so much more valuable than that. My wife is so much more valuable than that. You are so much more valuable than that. And if you're in a place where you kind of like seeing your spouse fall, you kind of like seeing some stuff happen, you kind of like the drama, hey, let's pray. Let's pray, let's read, let's worship, let's serve, let's get closer to God, because the closer you get to God, the more you'll see your spouse like God sees your spouse. If I look at my wife how I see my wife, I'll love her one day, I'll be mad at her one day, I'll be irritated one day, but when I say, God, that is your daughter, I now see her through the lens of God, and it helps me when there are seasons where it's hard. And it helps me. But this says, not if you fall, it says the person who falls alone is in real trouble. And you can be married and still be alone. You know that. We've all been there. You've got someone right next to you hogging the blankets, but you're still alone. You're still alone. And that's when you'll try to find something to pick you up that you're not supposed to find to pick you up. Most addictions aren't actual addiction problems. Most addictions are relationship problems. Like, you'll fall, you'll be in a pit of addiction, you'll be in a depressed state. You don't have the right people around you, whether friends, spouse, family, whatever, and they're not there to pick you up when you fall. Thus, you look for something to pick you up, and it may be a drink, it may be a drug, it may be porn, it may be eating, whatever it is, but your addiction problem isn't an actual addiction problem, it's a relationship problem. You've got to find people that are going to be there when they see that you're falling, when they see that you're anxious, when they see that you're depressed. And if you're married, your spouse has got to be that for you. They've got to be there to pick you up, to help get you out of that. That's why God has them in your life. But when you fall alone, he says, when you fall alone, you're in real trouble. And in our marriage, if you've been married for one day, 1 year, 10 years, 50 years, you will fall. But that's why you have somebody in your life with you to help you, to pick you up. The word help is all over. Help, help, help. Do you have the person, and are you the person that helps? And if not, that's easy. Let's start praying. Let's start being better. Let's start helping our spouse. So it says in verse 10, but someone who falls alone is in real trouble. Likewise, two people lying close together can keep each other warm, but how can one be warm alone? How can I be warm? Because as a human, right? As somebody with skin, with flesh, with bones, your desire is to be warm, isn't it? Your desire is to be comforted, cared for, loved with somebody. That's our desire. That's what we want. And when we don't get it, we will try to warm ourselves. And that's dangerous. That's when things start getting a little shady. That's when you start sending messages you know you shouldn't send. That's when you start looking for things, eating things, taking things, drinking things you know you shouldn't, but you're looking. Listen, even as a married person, this happens. You're looking to warm yourself. He says, no. If you're married, you have that person. You have that person. Find the warmth, the comfort, the care in that person, because that person was sent to you by God. Hear me. So yes, you find it in a devotion time. You find it in prayer. You find it in all of that. But you also find it in the person that God gave you. You find it in the person God gave you. But the dangerous part is when you start to warm yourself, you're going to get into trouble. You are. Ask me how I know. You get yourself into trouble and you do things. When you're cold, hear me, when you're cold for a long period of time, you do desperate things. You ever seen those things where people get stuck out in the Antarctic and they start eating things they normally wouldn't, they start doing things they normally wouldn't? Why? Because they've been cold for a long period of time. And you can be married and be cold for a long period of time. So you've got to be careful. You've got to be careful. Because listen, we've got to protect our marriages. Just because you have a wedding ring doesn't mean the enemy's not going to attack you. Just because you said I do doesn't mean the enemy's not going to attack you. Just because you had a cool wedding hashtag doesn't mean the enemy's still not going to come after you. We have got to protect our marriages. I'm praying when I don't feel like it. I'm reading when I don't feel like it. I'm worshiping when I don't feel like it. Because the enemy's not going to take my marriage from me. I'm going to work and fight for my marriage. I am. But we have to be unified. Unified together. Helping each other. Because look at the very end and then we're done. Likewise, two people lying together can keep each other warm. But how can one be warm alone? Warm alone. A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated. But two can stand back to back and conquer. It doesn't say you're not going to. It guarantees you're going to be attacked. I get to choose, are we going to fight for this thing? My marriage is too valuable to let the enemy take it. So I'm going to work for it. I'm going to pray for it. I'm going to love my wife even when I don't feel like it. You've got to love your husband even when you don't feel like it. We are not letting the enemy take our marriage. We're going to be unified. Unified. And nothing's going to take our marriage from us. Nothing. But that's what the enemy wants to do. If he can drive a wedge in between the people that are supposed to be the closest on this planet, he can do it with anybody else, right? He can do it with anybody else. And so we have got to stand back to back and conquer. God's done it. God's called us to it. God's given us the power. He's given us all this. We just have to look at our marriage and say, it's worth it. It's worth it. We're not letting something come and take it over. We are going to fight for our marriage. We are. And so, man, I don't know who you are, where you are. I have no idea. you're married, you want to get married, but this is an intense thing. I want to pray for you. That God would begin to do something in you, that He would change something in you. And if you're a husband or a wife, that you've been missing it. Hey, I do it all the time. That you would just start praying. That you would say, hey God, help me be the man or woman you've called me to be. Help me do what you've called me to do. Help me see my wife how you see my wife. Help me see my husband how you see my husband. Because you can change it all. Just because your marriage hasn't been good up until this point doesn't mean it can't be great after this. It's not done. It's just started. But you've got to take it serious. You've got to take it serious. And if you haven't heard this in a while, your marriage is worth it. Your wife is worth it. Your husband is worth it. They're worth the work. Their spirit is worth it. Their heart is worth it. Their mind is worth it. We just have to see them and look at them and say, God, who have you created them to be? Help me to help them. Not get mad at them, not get angry at them, not get irritated at them, not let the enemy come between us. But my marriage is worth it, so I'm gonna fight as hard as I can for it. We have to. And maybe you've never thought that before. Today's the day. Today's the day we start fighting for our marriage. Lord, we love you. We honor you. We thank you. We praise you. And God, I thank you that you've brought my wife into my life. If I haven't said it before, I'm going to say it now. God, I thank you. She is the greatest thing that's ever happened to me, and I'm going to fight for it. We're going to fight for our marriages, our spouses. We're going to pray. We're going to read. We're going to worship. We're going to serve together. Because we want to be unified, and do everything you've created us to do. God, we love you, we praise you, we honor you. It's your name we pray, and everybody say it. Amen.
God blesses those who are poor. God blesses those who mourn. God blesses those who are humble. God blesses those who are hungry. God blesses those who are merciful. God blesses those whose hearts are pure.